அவை வணங்க.
Session, the problem-based learning in obstetrics. Pregnancy with its physiological changes can have exaggerated effects in conditions like obesity, valvular heart disease, eclampsia and bleeding. I call upon Dr. Vennila Rajgopal, who will conduct the session. She's a consultant anaesthetist at Apollo Maternity Hospital, Chennai. Her special interests are obstetric anaesthesia and airway. I would also call upon all the panelists, Dr. Amarja Nagre. She is a consultant cardiac anaesthetist. Dr. Chethan Koteswara, specialist anaesthesia and our army man. Dr. Madhusoodhan Jagirdar, who is a senior consultant at Cloud 9 Hospital, Bengaluru. Dr. Siva Krishna Kota, who is also an obstetric anaesthetist from Cornish Hospital, Abu Dhabi. And Dr. Vineet Gupta, a senior consultant from Cloud 9 Hospital, Gurugram.
A very good morning again to one and all here. So we are getting into the nitty-gritty details of obstetric anesthesia here, and I am glad to be here with our panel of experienced obstetric anesthetists who are going to give us tips and tricks to deal with problems that we face. I don't think we face any more of ASA 1 and 2 obstetric patients. They come up with a huge package of problems, and we are often here in a very emotional situation as well, the anxiety, emotions, and of course our obstetricians to deal with. So we head on to our session here. So we get on, we're going to have some case scenarios to discuss. So this is our first patient, a 30-year-old primiparous woman, 125 kilos, quite a short person with a BMI of 50, known IUGR, previous bad obstetric history and hence been on clexane, comes up with a premature rupture of membranes at 35 weeks. How do we go about this? I would request Dr. Madhu sir to start with, please.
Morning everybody. Hope I am audible. 30-year-old primary with 125 kg with a BMI of 50. With the IUGR and a history of PROM, that means it's an emergency case. We have to take up within 30 minutes, the surgery has to be taken up. Just I want to make it clear how when the patient had clexane.
Yes, thankfully she's had the previous night and she's come in at about 8 o'clock in the morning.
If
she had it at 6 p.m.
If she's due, I would like to withhold first that the clexane. And my immediate concern is two lives are there, because I'm worried about the oxygenation of the patient. In an obese patient, airway is a big problem for us because of the large tongue, and then increased pharyngeal mucosal edema, laryngeal edema, and there is a thick neck, and there's a fat deposition posteriorly in the cervical spines, in between posteriorly, nape of the neck. So all these, and if the history of OSA, if it is there, then it really scares me.
Yeah.
To airway problems. So I have to keep my airway set, everything ready, including the what all things we have at your disposal.
Yes.
Like buji, LMA, the second line of treatment, then laryngoscopes, tubes, and whatnot, nasal airways, all these things.
Yes.
I would
so
like to keep.
We have to be quite prepared in this
airway,
patient.
Airway trolley has to be ready, set up.
Yes.
Set
so
up.
As sir has rightly pointed, we have to be very cautious about the timing of the anticoagulant when it was given. As per the ASTRA guidelines and the latest update early this year, we have to allow for 12 hours after the last dose when it is a prophylactic dose, and more than 24 hours if they are on a therapeutic dose. So if you end up with such patients who had a history of DVT and they are on therapeutic dose, then you might very well be in a situation to do a GA, and we will have to be ready for that. So when it comes to general anesthesia versus regional, this is the crux of the point, as he's just rightly pointed out. Would you like to add anything, Dr. Vineet?
Personally, if the patient has got clexane in the last night, you said 8 p.m. and patient early in the morning around 8 a.m.
Yes.
I am a man of general anesthesia, basically.
Correct.
I will not take a chance when clexane is 12 hours before, and maybe if the airway is acceptable, I'll go for the GA.
You'd go for a GA, yes. And as he rightly said, how ready is our setup to deal with it? Are we in a tertiary place with every reasonable equipment that we have to deal with a difficult airway? Is she really a difficult airway? Can I manage this? And added to that, we have the stress of time and pressure. So, I mean, PROM, they might well have some time to deal with, and you have time. It's not. So what would be very important in examination here would also be the examination status. What is the CTG like? What are the fetal movements like? And what does the obstetrician want to do? So that would also be a very valid point, and how long we have. So this is what we elicited as the prime concerns. According to the NAP4 audit, airway can still be an issue, and added to the stress, we need to be highly prepared as a team and not just the anesthetist to deal with it. And Dr. Madhu pointed out about the obstructive sleep apnea. Would you like to add any points to that, Dr. Shiva? Your mic, please.
Hello. Obese patients, of course, the biggest threat is the in our population, the obesity is much higher than what we see in a day-to-day life here back in India. So what we do, we ask them whether they use any CPAP. Most of the patients, they say OSA, but they are off treatment. Absolutely fine with that. We have a very, very high threshold for going for GA for any patient, unless until we have a contraindication for spinal to start with. Any patient having a CPAP machine, we ask them to get their machine themselves and the preset setting, what is there, and we keep it in the PACU, I mean the post-op anesthesia, the post-anesthesia care unit. So if at all you need post general anesthesia, it becomes very handy because you are having a machine with a setting what she uses optimal, which is optimum for her, and their relatives, they know about it.
Yes, so it's best, I think patients are often best people, and the patient relatives are often best to decide what are the settings, and we get a respiratory physiotherapist as well in hand in our unit. So moving on, once the patient, the other important thing that I would raise here, whether it's regional or GA, is a left lateral tilt. How important is that in a obese patient particularly? I think we've had this discussion before.
Yes, left lateral twist is very, very important because it causes the gravid uterus, that too in a obese patient, causes the aortocaval compression, and whatever the venous return is going to come back as a preload to the heart. These patients can have a lot of heart elements as well. So left lateral tilt is very, very important and has to be taken care of. Yes.
See, and it's also important that once the spinal or GA is given, the hypotension is more pronounced in these patients with a sudden drop in blood pressure, and the autoregulatory curve does not quite work in the same way as they were pre-spinal. So it's very important to preload or co-load as necessary and have your vasopressors in hand. So this is what we're talking about. This is an article by Dr. Arvind Palaniswamy, whom I happen to work with in Liverpool, who's currently in Washington. He said, if we can't predict it, how can we prevent it? As in, this is an article which talks about how to be well prepared for any event of situation when it's a difficult airway, because you cannot actually put things together on that particular day. It has to be prepared as a team beforehand. And Dr. Madhu had to say, yeah, about the ramp position for obstetric patients and who are obese. We'll have to observe this more critically because the oxygen reserve here is quite less, and we have to be very proactive in making sure we position the patient correct. So, and what about regional? Is it really difficult?
No, I don't think with the palpation of the spine, another thing, you should be given a fairly acute. It will give a very good idea whether we could be able to tap the spinal or epidural.
Okay.
I would like to examine the patient in a sitting position, and I would like to proceed in a sitting position to go.
Yeah, so if all of them are like the patient on the left, we'll be quite glad when we enter the labor ward. But most of them are like that in my practice anyway, at least. And that's what Shiva was also saying. That. So would you, anybody else who's got any other aids to help with epidurals and spinals?
Okay. One of the biggest advantages of getting ultrasound, another thing we missed in the focus, I think the use of ultrasound for localizing the spinal and epidural space, which is, we think it's the bread and butter of most of us. So this, when you started the concept of ultrasound in this, I think Dr. Karmakar, who started, wrote a lovely article to how to do that, see the signatures doing a scan. More than, one of the study was saying more than 50% of the case we anesthetists, despite being experienced doing thousands of spinals, we overestimate the level. The Taufier line is not right at all to determine the L3, L4. If only any marker, physical marker is consistent, there is the dimple which is always at S1, S2, which you don't get in every patient. So looking at the L3, L4, for by Taufier line, it's a wrong thing, and it's even wrong when you're doing for an obese patient obese because patient. You have a skin fat. So they going for the using the ultrasound for localizing the space is a big, big help, and most of the time it works.
So it is, I think in the coming days to come, we'll be using more of this epidural, ultrasound for epidural, because we are beginning to use them in our hospital, because a lot of patients do not want a second attempt, obviously. And palpation of space can get very difficult, and really obese patients, we are beginning to use them so we can avoid the pain related to epidural as well. And how long needles are they useful, Major?
Yeah, definitely. You have to have them in your armamentarium.
Do we stock? Do you stock them in your department?
Yes,
do you
yes.
Make it available.
Yeah, we have a lot. Like Shiva said, we have a lot of patients there who are.
I mean, how about Dr. Vineet in Indian scenario? Do you occasionally get to use them once a year, once in 6 months?
No, we don't have ultrasound available for this.
Or long needles. Not necessarily.
Long spinal needles we have.
You have stock. Yeah. So we try to keep stock of them because it's quite, annoying, because you know this is a big patient and you've made an effort, you've spotted the right space, you're almost there, and then you're hitting the hub, the fat of the skin, and you just wish the needle would just go in another 2 millimeters, and hence we decided to get a stock. We used to have it in Liverpool Women's where I worked before, and I thought, maybe once in 6 months, I feel there is a need for it here. And I don't know, anybody else using long needles fairly frequently in obese? You do. So there's quite a number of people who get to use.
I would like to add one thing. One case I have seen last month.
You can speak up a little.
I put a normal routine spinal needle, and patient was quite obese. And it was going in and in. The confirmation of this intrathecal space. The CSF is coming only when I'm pushing the needle. So for the giving of drug, I have to keep pushing it.
Yes.
As I leave it, it comes out.
Comes out.
So sometimes it happens. So if you don't have 11
pad of fat where the slipping of the needle, and it's the same that applies for catheter also. The epidural catheter can slip out.
So if you don't have this 11 centimeter needle, if you have only 9 centimeter needle, maybe you need to keep it pushing while injecting the drug.
So this lady, you go on to give a spinal after optimizing, making sure that her dose has been more than 12 hours. She gets a spinal. Caesarean goes uneventfully as for the delivery. But post-delivery, there is a continuous oozing on table. Do you think the risk of bleeding is more or higher in obese? What does evidence say?
Basically, you know that pregnancy is a hypercoagulable state. So the risk of bleeding as such, you cannot associate with that hypercoagulability. This bleeding is usually because of atonic uterus or a uterus that is just not contracting despite all your drugs. So that is not linked, but definitely if there is a atonic uterus, then.
So it's because of multiple causes. Anything,
and,
Dr.
The Amarja? Patient was on Clexane as well.
So it might well be that that as a reason, as well as there's multiple studies to say that obese patients have a high risk for PPH, atonic uterus, and she might well have received tocolytics because she was 35 weeks, we don't know. So that is something we need to know. So it could be due to the 4Ts, a loss of tone due to trauma if it was normal delivery, thrombin, and tissue damage. So your first line of management would be, Dr. Shiva, would you like to take over?
Yeah, as we know, let me give a holistic approach. We, whenever the patient bleeds, we need to have a couple of hemostasis, what we're looking for. One is obstetric hemostasis using the uterotonics, as we all know. Second thing is the surgical hemostasis by doing the hysterectomy or various procedures. Third thing is the systemic hemostasis, which we anesthetize a big, big role. The fourth one, which we never give importance, is the organizational hemostasis. What does that mean? We should have a policy, we should have a code, we should have a multidisciplinary team, we should have a preparedness, not very important thing at the end, a documentation and the debriefing.
Absolutely.
We never give importance. In one of the studies recently they did, they saw 200 patients, they started a policy, implemented a policy, they analyzed 200 patients retrospectively and 200 prospective. The difference was nothing, they had the same blood products they use, everything used. The only change was implementation of a policy, and there was 30% increase in improvement in the mortality and morbidity.
You're absolutely right. I'm sure everyone here agrees who worked in a system where there is a system in place. And there is something called the massive transfusion protocol that should be alarmed at, and there should be a bell raised as soon as you have a sick patient bleeding on table, where everyone in the chain of events is alerted and the blood arrives and everything is dealt with in a systematic manner, as opposed to a chaotic manner where the anesthetist has to actually coordinate most of the diseases. So what is the role of tranexamic acid here in this lady? So you've given your syntocinon and...
Okay, I skipped the uterotonics, I did more, it was not intentional. The thing is, what the final summary, because of the lack of time, I'll just give the what are the recommendation by the RCOG or the Australian Council, what we are recommending. Oxytocin, the 5 units slow IV over 2 to 3 minutes. No more bolus. There are reports of cardiac arrest, so they have practically stopped. There are some trials going on comparing the 2 to 3 milligram oxytocin to 5 milligram. Forget about the 10 and 20 what we used to long back. So it's a 5 units IV slowly over 2 minutes. Then you have, if you're seeing a patient with a high risk, like this patient with an obese who had a Clexane, so we will go for a syntocin, I mean oxytocin infusion for next 3 to 4 hours at 10 units per hour. This is the recommended RCOG dose.
Yeah, so we put 40 units in 500 ml and run it at 125 cc per hour. I think that's what we follow.
The second line, it's very clear cut. The second line comes as a the methergine, because it causes a sustained tetanic contractions. You give a 0.2 milligram. You can repeat a dose after 15 minutes. After that, every 2 hourly, up to 5 doses. So it comes to 1 gram. This is the second line. There are many studies comparing oxytocin methergine. It's oxytocin much better than the methergine one. Okay? And the retained placenta and everything, chances is less with syntocin. Unless if you start giving methergine soon after the baby delivery, chances of placental retention is more.
Yeah.
So you are dealing with two problems. Then the third line, like we all do the same thing, the carboprost.
Yep.
Again, given as a 250 microgram.
Which we are often quite hesitant to give because of the, particularly in an awake patient.
This patient, I will be very careful, because if you have a history of obstetric sleep apnea, you don't want to meddle up with anything, with the bronchospasm or anything. So you have to see the patient's pre-op condition before deciding the drugs.
So coming to the role of tranexamic acid in PPH. About the woman trial, we quite have a well-established evidence to say that 1 gram dose for an adult obstetric patient is wise to use if the bleeding is excessive on table, and the anesthetist and surgeon feel that despite the massage and the first couple of line of management of PPH drug uterotonics, a dose of tranexamic acid is well known to reduce the PPH. So how do we balance it with the risk of DVT in this lady? So she's been on Clexane, and we tried to not clot her, and she's obese, and we're going to put Floetrons on her. And now we're going to balance giving a dose of tranexamic acid. What do you think, Dr. Chethan?
The ACCP recommendations from 2012 are very, very clear. She has to be on a DVT prophylaxis.
Absolutely.
There is no doubt about
so
that.
So this one dose Tranexa is not going to cause a harm. If anything, I think we have to keep a close eye on her, where she goes post-operatively and how we deal with her from here on. It's a close monitoring that actually matters. And what is the ratio of blood products transfusion? I think it's a very, very important. We just established a massive transfusion protocol should be in place. For want of time, I'm going to skip this part because I think there are more scenarios to deal with.
Okay, the simple answer is there is no ideal ratio. We should be very thankful to the crash study, which eventually given us impetus to do our research in various fields. There is no ideal ratio. Only thing what have changed over the last decade or 15 years is the concept from plasma to something which contains the fibrinogen more. We are talking about fibrinogen and fibrinogen. There is no doubt in that. We have multiple studies, starting from the Chadwick study in 2007, the landmark one. Any patient having a less than 2 gram fibrinogen has a 100% positive predictive value for a
so that is the ballpark of figure PPH. Of 2 grams.
At the same time, less if your fibrinogen level pre-op is more than 4, 80% chance that you will not have a PPH. So look at the thing, the 100%, they are not telling anything about 70, 80, 100% positive predictive value. Soon after the studies have went on, they said the same thing, that it's an independent factor in a univariate and a multivariate analysis to be linked with the PPH. So how we replace this one? If I'm not wrong, 3-4 years back, we had a lot of using the plasma. For last 2 years, we haven't used a single unit of plasma, despite being doing every day one placenta previa or accreta. So the concept is how to give the fibrinogen. There is no ratio. What we do, we have 2 units. We give initially the RBC. If at all we need more than that, we start the protocol. We just announce a code called massive obstetric hemorrhage. So the blood bank knows.
I have to stop you, Shiva, because that is a lengthy topic and we have 3 more scenarios. We will discuss this in FB soon. So massive transfusion protocol and the ratios is a huge topic in itself and we will discuss that. So what I wanted to stress more on this question itself is, despite the uterotonics and the massage and the Behlen's suturing, which is the line of management as we go down, at some point there is a continuous oozing and there is a generalized oozing and there is a point where we have to decide where this patient has to go from here, because we got to save her life. If she continues to bleed, we're going to be in trouble. She's going to be in trouble. So the benefit of uterine artery embolization versus uterine artery ligation on table. So it is well suggested now that if you're in a, so it particularly matters whether you're in an isolated nursing home or a tertiary referral center, or even shifting in a tertiary center from main OT to a cath lab can be disastrous. You may lose time within that half an hour of movement from here to there. So we have more evidence. Sorry, this is what Shiva wanted to elicit, but I'm going to skip here. So if it is a normal delivery and she's had a PPH, we declare it as an emergency, alert the team, correct coagulopathy, and further down, uterotonic started, shift her to OT. You know, this is the latest guidance, and it's very, very important to alert the whole team. Once she's in OT, as we suggested, we have the uterotonics, tranexamic acid, uterine tamponade ballooning. I mean, the very, very important thing that can be applied to in any hospital, all the trainees in obstetrics are trained to do, the midwives should be aware of that. And if she's on table or if she has to go into OT, the Behlen's suturing or the hemostatic sutures, and they may have to ligate the uterine or the internal iliacs on table. If there is still further bleeding and the uterus is the reason, she might have to have a subtotal hysterectomy. So this decision-making protocol has to be alerted to everyone in the department and it has to be followed. So, and there is adequate evidence to say that uterine artery ligation success rate is higher. And so for one next scenario, we move on to Dr. Chethan, would you like to give us some, throw some light on non-obstetric surgery in obstetric patients? So say this lady is coming up in second trimester for acute appendicectomy. In pain, the surgeon says she's got acute appendix, I need to do it now. What would you suggest?
In our Facebook group, there have been some discussion about this, I think a couple of months back, when a friend of mine from Mangalore, he posted about in a small freelancing setup, he did a case with only oxygen, 100% oxygen with an ambu bag, and he used isoflurane. I don't know how he connected the isoflurane to the circuit. So then there was some discussion about use of nitrous oxide in the pregnancy and about other evidence related to use of anesthetic drugs. Now, as far as evidence is concerned, we have to understand that you cannot allow any clinical trials in pregnancy, because it will be unethical to do that.
Yes.
And all of our studies which have come, they are all retrospective studies, and there is no meta-analysis because there is no randomization. So what the current evidence is that none of your anesthetic agents are teratogenic.
Yes.
And most of the insult that happens to the growth of fetus or the fetus is because of hypoxia to the fetus. So what you have to do as an anesthetist, that you have to make sure that fetus doesn't have any insult due to hypoxia or hypercarbia or hypotension, because uteroplacental bed is not auto-regulated. So you have to make sure that the perfusion is good and oxygenation is good.
Thank you, Dr. Chethan. That's absolutely right. So the patient needs anesthesia, she needs anesthesia. So we need to give the right anesthesia. There's no such thing as a light anesthesia trying to hip hop here and there. She needs anesthesia. You might as well explain to her, she'll be asleep. Avoid hypoxia, hypotension. Laparoscopy is not a risk. In fact, it's better than laparotomy. As far as drugs are concerned, we avoid nitrous and benzos. Everything else in anesthesia appear to be safe so far. And in terms of antibiotics and aspiration prophylaxis and thromboprophylaxis, very important to follow as per the usual guidelines. And what about the dose of tocolytics? Tocolytics?
Tocolytics, the current recommendations are that they have there is no evidence that they will be beneficial. But if they start, then you can use either isoxaprine or ritonavir. Or NTG
patches.
So
it is not actually recommended. So
it is not recommended, but if it starts, then you have to treat that.
You have to be going on, So this is the decision-making flowchart. The best done in the second trimester. If it is semi-elective, we postpone it. And if it's emergency, it has to be done, and you just do what is appropriate for the patient, having explained the risks to the family. So we have a very grim scenario here, a primary with a high blood pressure of 210, 120 at 36 weeks with headache and giddiness. Her prior blood tests that were done at booking say she has inadequate hemoglobin, serology negative, group O positive. The obstetric registrar puts her on Maxelf and starts an oral labetalol, and you get an information saying the consultant will come in to do the cesarean in a couple of hours, and you got to go and see her for PAC. How, what exactly would you like to do in terms of investigation? Any one specific test you would like to ask, one or two, in addition to what you already know about her?
See, looking at this case falls under severe preeclampsia. There is a difference between eclampsia and preeclampsia. Severe preeclampsia. This is severe preeclampsia.
Absolutely.
Because it shows the blood pressure is already 210 by 110. Yeah.
So we have
only 15 minutes
sick patient with us
to control the blood pressure. Though we have 2 hours to wait for the CS, I would like to repeat the coagulation profile and hematocrit at least.
Yes, absolutely. So we want to know what the eosinies are like and the coagulation profile as well. How is she an impending eclampsia? What is happening? And also to make a decision.
Though it is suggested to do the liver function test and renal function test also to rule out the organ involvement.
How would you like to optimize this lady? So you send a eosinies, your creatinine is okay, the sodium comes back as 122.
See, this patient really need to be controlled within 15 minutes. Otherwise, she has a fair chances of throwing a seizure. So we have first line drugs available like nifedipine, labetalol and hydralazine. Hydralazine is least using drug in out of three.
Mm.
So
there is still a role for that.
We can use nifedipine, in fact, and labetalol. Nifedipine we can use 10 milligram to 20 milligram.
So you'll continue the Maxelf, and we have to observe her closely in an obstetric HTU. It's very important where this lady is and who is observing. She may need invasive monitoring, and also we need to, what is very important about discussing anesthesia with the patient and the family here?
See, it all depends on her coagulation profile. For me, there are two most important things. One is the coagulation profile, other is the airway status.
Yes.
This patient will be having a severe upper respiratory tract edema, as well as fair chances of having pulmonary edema also. So if she has pulmonary edema and airway edema, that itself shows
you have an organ involvement. Difficult situation there.
Yeah.
So that would help us decide, and we have to be prepared for all eventualities. As he said, she might throw a fit intraoperatively, immediate postoperatively, and we need to keep a close eye on this lady. So is there a role of Dexmed?
Yeah, dexmedetomidine has a good role, and recently we are using it, though we don't have, but it is suggested we can use it, and it's a good alpha.
So I think more and more of dexmed in GA patients, we are using them for induction to prevent any laryngoscopy.
It's a good analgesic, amnesic, as well as decreases the sympathetic tone. Yeah.
So we need to monitor her in HTU. She was there in the HTU for a couple of days, and the second day down the line, she started developing severe hypertension again despite the continuous input of antihypertensives and cardiology, and we were keeping an eye on her. At middle of the day, we get called saying that her blood pressure is shot up again and she's got severe headache and she's also tachypneic and tachycardic. What would be your differential diagnosis at this stage, Dr. Amarja?
Since she is only 36 hours postpartum and has shortness of breath, tachycardia, tachypnea, first and foremost, I would think of pain and anxiety. But then there's a SpO2 fall of up to 86%, so that gets ruled out. And now what comes to mind is basically in the differential diagnosis, we can just think of pulmonary thromboembolism first, as the SpO2 is falling. Then next can be the accelerated hypertension because she was a hypertensive case. Then comes the heart failure. Yes, so these are three. And once we rule out this, these three, there is one more diagnosis, which is a diagnosis of exclusion, actually, and that is peripartum cardiomyopathy.
Absolutely.
So when we initially had 2 hours in hand, I would have just liked to get the echo machine, if it is available in the premises, and just put a probe on the precordium to see if she had
I'd like to take Amarja to my purchase manager and get the echo for my HTU. Yeah.
But since it is a non-invasive, real-time modality, why not just keep the probe on the precordium in a preeclamptic patient who is so much hypertensive, yes? So yeah, that we just come to the diagnosis easily and quickly later on if we have such scenarios.
Yes, so we are trying here to differentiate, is it a capillary leak, ARDS, pulmonary edema, or is she got a peripartum cardiomyopathy? What is her regional wall motion abnormality like? And you do a quick ABG to make sure the pulmonary causes are ruled out. And typically the obese, PIH, IVF pregnancies, they all have a high risk to go. Older patients have a high risk to go into such problems. So once you've made a diagnosis out of exclusion, how would you optimize this lady's? I mean, she's in an isolated hospital, in a HTU. Where would you take her from here? How to optimize her now?
Now, this is a case of postpartum cardiomyopathy, and you have diagnosed it. On echo, you just find that there is a reduced LV function. That is, the ejection fraction has reduced 45% or less. And then there is dilated left ventricle, you see. The diameter of the left ventricle has been increased. The area is increased. And the fractional shortening is also less than 30%. So you come to cardiomyopathy diagnosis. Why I'm telling this is the severity of this cardiomyopathy is also important in managing it, because our regional anesthesia or general anesthesia is going to matter then. What are the drugs of choice? If this is a severe cardiomyopathy patient, straight away you go for a general anesthesia. Yes, and if it is something above moderate, and you can epidural.
So, yeah, this is post-operative situation. So
yes, she is a post-operative case. Okay, okay, fine. Yes, and then the drugs of choice now are mainly the diuretics, the digoxin for the heart failure, and the blood pressure drugs like the beta blockers, the metoprolol, labetalol will take care of.
So this lady needed and, IV labetalol.
Yes, and the anticoagulation has to be also done. Yeah.
So we have to be cautious when you use beta blockers when they're already going into pulmonary edema. Make sure the nifedipine is in, a little dose of Lasix, get her propped up, put some high flow oxygen on, get the cardiologist or the, if we can do the echo, we do that. And where and should she be? Can she be just in a post-op ward and labor ward? No, she needs more intense
monitoring.
No,
she has to be transferred to an intensive care unit where a thorough monitoring can be done. And for the monitoring purpose also, you can just go for the invasive central venous line placement can be done. And if at all required, invasive arterial blood pressure monitoring has to be done.
Yes. So we need to be very careful about where we keep them and have a close eye on these ladies, and that should be very important. So just a quick one slide answer because we are running out of time. We have 3 minutes here. We have two patients which I encountered fairly recently. One is a case of rheumatic heart disease, MS, MR with pulmonary hypertension,
moderate on clexane. That was the only drug she's on. She's well maintained. She was one of our nurses who was optimized, and she was coming for an urgent LSA. She had broken her membranes while she was on shift, and we had to take her for urgent LSAs. Compared to another girl who came in through the door at 6 in the evening, unbooked 30-year-old, very breathless, and because she was so breathless, we and saturations around 84, 85, and full of Krebs, we had to do an emergency echo down in the ER, and she had MS, MR, and pulmonary hypertension of 100. And we had to start digoxin and beta blocker immediately. So how would you deal with, what one point would you suggest when you have two different kind of same pathology but a different scenarios?
When we have such scenarios, in the first patient, if it is an elective or an emergency
cesarean section. Both are urgent and emergency. So.
Both are urgent and emergency, yeah. Yes. Yeah. So, because the first patient is on clexane, the regional anesthesia we cannot give. So, general anesthesia has to be taken care of. But whenever it is possible, like in the second case, regional anesthesia is the best for this patient. So you can always go for epidural anesthesia in case of any patient. If the even if the first patient was not on clexane and the second patient also, what you have to take in mind is patient has mitral stenosis, mitral regurgitation, and pulmonary hypertension. So you have to see which is the predominant lesion. Is it the stenotic lesion predominant or the mitral regurgitation that is predominant in this patient? Both patients are having pulmonary hypertension as well. So let's think of that again. But when we take into consideration the stenotic and the regurgitation lesion, the goals of anesthesia are totally different in between the two. So if the predominant is the stenotic, you don't want tachycardia in this. But if it is regurgitant, you want tachycardia in this. Not a severe tachycardia, in moderation, or a mild tachycardia is preferable. Contractility has to be maintained in both. Yes?
Yes.
Preload has to be taken care of in both. And the afterload has to be also taken care of more so in the regurgitant lesions. Yes. Also the stenotic lesions. So this is according to the cardiac grid. What I always tell is the heart rate, rhythm, contractility, preload and afterload has to be taken care of.
Goals of anesthesia.
The pulmonary hypertension component is there. I would just like to add, because in our scenarios, there's a list of drugs that we give for pulmonary hypertensive patients, like the bosentan and the epoprostenol, iloprost. But what we can always do is give NTG nebulization.
Okay.
Yes, we have 5 mg per ml ampule, and just that ampule of 5 ml has to be diluted till 20 ml. Yes, and that forms 250 mics of NTG. Give 25 mics per kg. 25 mics per kg is the dose for NTG nebulization. That is very readily available. You can give that, and the
and has that got a role in obstetrics. In obstetrics,
yes, yes,
as well?
In obstetrics, okay. Only I'm talking. It has a role in congenital heart disease, obstetrics, and there are several papers on it. So that is very handy and can be practiced.
Sure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Amarja. That adds a great value. So this lady, even
I
though she was
the details on the Facebook group about this.
Yeah. Sure. Thank you. So we are just on dot time. Thank you, panelists. Just to add value, this lady had had clexane before. She was very controlled. We did her under epidural. But she was in failure, so had to be done under GA and sent to CCU post-op. But both ways, mom and baby did well. So thank you, panelists. And thank you very much for excellent content. Hope you all enjoyed.
Thank you, Vennila, for conducting the session so well and in time.